Hi, welcome to Tampa News and Talk.com. And my name is Al McCray. I'm the host of this show. We've been around now for 7 years. But before I start talking in detail, let me give it a disclaimer. We are Tampa's last place news. Well, you might as well be honest. I mean, we are Tampa Bay's last place news, okay? So you won't get breaking news. You get conversation, investigations, and a variety of guests. Like I say, we've been around now for 7 years. We do all kinds of interviews with lawyers, police chief, restaurateurs, business people, nonprofit. So if you want publicity for your organization, hey, please contact me. So again, my name is Al McCray. I'm the host of the Al McCray Show on TampaNewsAndTalk.com. Now today, we have a very distinguished guest. Let me read his business card because I can't remember his name every time. Your last name is Sichta?
Sichta.
Robert Sichta.
That's correct.
And you the attorney for CARE, correct?
I am an attorney at CARE, yes.
Okay. You work there like full-time or you just part-time?
I'm there full-time.
Okay. I got a bunch of questions to ask you.
Let's go.
Are you ready for the questions?
I am.
If the question seems too personal or too investigative, just wiggle one finger and I'll back off. How's that?
That's very fair.
Okay, now, what does CARE stand for?
CARE stands for Counsel. Well, let me give you the concept first. CARE is about better relations between people. And in this instance, it's the Council for American-Islamic Relations. We're the Florida branch. We're all over the United States.
How long has it been around in Tampa?
In Tampa, I understand we've been here for 17 years.
Same location?
No, pretty much the same area, but not the same specific location.
And how long have you been an attorney with CARE?
I've been with CARE this past year.
Okay.
Before that, I practiced law since 1975, so I've been around a bit, interspersed with a couple of other careers.
What type of law do you practice?
I specialize at CARE in immigration law. I also do other things, but I stay in immigration law and in federal practice because I'm not a member of the Florida Bar. I am a member of the Bar in Colorado and in Virginia.
So how do you become a member of the Federal Bar?
A member of the Federal Bar? Well, first you have to become a member of a state bar.
Any state?
Yes, in the United States, any state. Then you become a member of the Federal District Bar for the Federal District Court in your area.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, you can then become a member of the Court of Appeals Bar. And if you're willing to spend the money and the time and not actually try cases there, you can become a member of the United States Supreme Court.
Okay, I've got a bunch of questions for you. It seems like every time there's an incident with an Arab involved, CARE gets flashed in the news. Why is that?
Well, that's because of who we are. One of our objectives is to do what we can to combat in a civil way what we call Islamophobia. There are a lot of misconceptions, a lot of misunderstandings, and a lot of stereotyping with respect to people who are Muslims.
But it seems like when there's a redneck incident or a white with negative leanings towards minority incident, people don't run to the Ku Klux Klan for an interview.
Not only that, but I will tell you, one of my professions that I'm the emeritus of now and will take an emeritus status in at the end of January of this next year is that of being the pastor of the United Church of Christ in Bradenton, Florida.
How long have you pastored there?
I've been there for, that will be in January, 6 years.
So you cannot lie to me then if you were a pastor before?
Oh, I can lie all the time,
okay.
But I'm not supposed to. We're not supposed to, as human beings with some sense of morality, lie. But with that understanding, I noticed just from a Christian perspective, not just an Islamic perspective, mm-hmm. that when people want to get a spokesperson for a particular faith, too often they go find someone who is probably one of the worst examples for that faith. In this area, here in Tampa, we have wonderful people who are able to speak about Islam. Just outstanding people. One of them is Hassan Shibley, okay. who is with our organization. Another is Nizar Hamzi, Wilfredo Ruiz, Maida Redenovic Aida. These people at our office, Tanya Clevenger, who is our civil rights director. These are awesome people who can really speak to the subject.
Okay. Do you have to be a Muslim to be a member of CARE?
What's really interesting about what we do, I am one of many people there, at least half, who are not Muslims. And yet we feel a kinship and a relationship, and I like to think have a really good understanding of and love, not only for the other people who work there, whether they are Muslims or whatever they are, but literally the idea of Islam, because I think we have a better understanding
of what we're doing. So there are non-Muslims.
Oh, many. Yes.
What's the ratio percentage-wise?
Again, I would say right now, and this is a very amateur perspective and would apply only to the Tampa office, with the understanding we have four offices statewide just in Florida, I would say about half our staff are not Muslims.
Okay. Does CARE get donations from any Arab countries?
No. Not that I'm aware of.
Okay.
Now, I'm not an expert on our donation side because I work on the legal side, but from my perspective and some of the people I work with, I have never heard of anybody talking about getting a donation from another country.
And several people have come to me and have asked me questions about CARE. Are you a front for a terrorist organization?
I really think that's funny when we get that, because if there's any group that is aligned with the idea of and ideals of being an American, it's CARE. We have great respect for the principles that make the United States the wonderful country it is. That's why people want to come here and be here and be part of it.
So you can in fact say that CARE is not a front for Islamic terrorist organization.
CARE is a front for people who seek wholeness and decency and morality. CARE is a front for people who are seeking refuge and safety. CARE is a front for people who have a base about them of goodness and decency that transcends even religions. That's what CARE is a front
for. What is CARE doing for the community here in Tampa?
Oh, it's a long list. I'll start with a couple of things and interrupt me anywhere you'd like. We are involved in social aspects and educational aspects, and not just teaching about Islam or something like that. That's a very small part of what we do. We literally have things where we work with the community. We have been part of the group and had a leadership role on things like the removal of Confederate statues in this community. That's part of where we have been on it, on the front line. We are very involved in making sure people are registered to vote and do vote without telling them how to vote or influencing that in any way, because we think the idea of an informed and educated and registered society of people is a better society in which to live and raise our children. We're very involved in education issues. We're very involved in civic events and affairs that reflect on all of us in good ways. Everything from the state fair to the county fair to clubs and organizations.
So you're really involved with the community?
We are part of the community, just like every other organization.
Now, your background, you are an immigration attorney.
That's what I do at CARE, yes.
But you're not a criminal attorney.
I have been.
Okay. You know, I was wondering why...
Well, no, let's amend that. There's an old joke. Are you a criminal lawyer? The answer is, aren't they all? But the reality is that because I am not a member of the Florida Bar, I don't do criminal law here at CARE or in Florida. But CARE doesn't do criminal law either.
But why is the word criminal in front of criminal attorneys?
Because...
The criminals.
That is such a fun question. Because they practice criminal law trying to defend people, trying to help them know their rights, trying to help them achieve those rights, and trying to make sure that we don't willy-nilly give people a fair trial and then hang them in kangaroo courts. That we observe a legal process that was established when this country was established, that is inherited from other great cultures. One of them, the culture of people who give us Islam. The other, the culture of people who come from Western Europe. These all blend in our society and in our system to create a legal system that is the envy of the world.
Now, on the immigration side, you are a full-time immigration attorney.
Yes.
What type of case do you handle within that immigration law?
Well, I'm going to tell you a little bit of what I like as well as what I do.
As brief as possible.
Yes, I like to do asylum because of the difference it makes in people's lives. And when people have asylum issues, I deal with those. But we help people to get citizenship. We help people to get green cards. We help people to get legal status here in the United States. We help them to get through the borders and here in various legal and appropriate ways. We help people who have trouble getting into the United States, who get held up and stopped, who have questions and get questioned. We work in all those ways. And then beyond that, if you are intent on coming to the U.S. or if you live here and you need to travel, we're involved in those issues for people too.
You know, I thought about this. If ISIS picked me up on the street, Al McCray on the street. I don't have on me proof of citizenship. I mean, how many Americans carry on them proof of citizenship? Do they haul me away to nearest ICE detention center? I could be there for weeks until someone get a copy of my birth certificate.
That's a very fair and astute observation, quite frankly. And I think you're referring to ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement. Yeah.
I mean, those guys are like cowboys, you know?
Well, I wouldn't characterize them as that, because my experience with this ICE people is these are people who are very intent on doing their jobs. And like everyone who does a job, they can get carried away.
But if they're low on their quarter for the week or month and got to get somebody, let's shake down that guy over there. He looks like he might be illegal.
Well, we hear about quotas, but what we concentrate on are individual cases, individual issues.
Do you think you have quarters at ICE, a quarter?
I tell you, as a lawyer, I honestly don't know. I hope not, because that doesn't speak well for America if that's the case. But I will tell you this. There is always the real risk that any citizen can be stopped by anybody who is in a position of authority and be stuck with being unable to prove that they are actually born here. That can be a difficult task. Ask yourself, how would you go about proving you're a citizen? Showing a driver's license?
Get someone to go to South Carolina to get an original copy of my own?
Absolutely. That would be the only way. Or producing a citizenship certificate. And even then, there are people who will question those things.
We got some pictures here of your organization.
Yeah.
We're going to put on the screen here. What does that picture represent?
Well, this is a part of what's going on in our office with some people who are doing organizational things. You see on the right in the back, MIDA, and then closer in the middle, you'll see AIDA. These are people who are organizing activities. Right now, they're probably organizing one of our four annual fundraising banquets.
Okay.
We have four offices around the state, our most recent one being in the Panhandle. And we go to all those locations actually in October and November, and we do fundraising banquets, which help us to be able to do these things because we're a nonprofit organization.
Nonprofit means that you spend all the money.
Nonprofit means that we rely on the funds that others give us and try to use that money judiciously and properly and appropriately in order to further the goals of this organization and the goals of the people who give us the funds. So
now we have some pictures. I'm going to cut you off here.
Yep.
Picture number two here. What is that?
That is Hassan Shibley. He is probably the best spokesman for care that I will ever meet.
He's an officer.
He is in charge of our office. He was in charge of our overall offices, and now he's graduated into a position of being a spokesperson statewide for care.
He's like mainly PR now.
Yeah, and PR and then some. Let's say PR on steroids, and he is awesome. His understanding of issues, his decency, his kindness, his caring about other human beings comes through when you hear him speak. And when I say that, I don't just mean Muslims. He happens to be a Muslim, but that's not
who you're going to find. In America?
I understand that he was born in Morocco and came here as a child. He's gone to law school here in the United States. He's a member of the bar.
Okay.
And he is, by the way, quite a good attorney, although he doesn't currently practice law at CARE. I wouldn't want to be on the other side of him. He's really
good. Okay, question number three. Who is this here?
Well, that is Nizar Hamzi. Now, this is a really interesting man. Nizar is in overall charge of us statewide organizationally in terms of our structure and our goals. And Nizar, along with doing that, is a deputy sheriff in Southeast Florida.
Really?
He covers a lot of ground. If you want to meet somebody who, if you just met him on the street, all you'd know is, boy, I like this guy. There's something about him. He really knows how to say things and do things and get things done in a decent way. There is something in his core that really speaks to all of us. That's the guy.
Okay, next question, number four. Who is this young lady here?
Well, that's Donya Clevenger. She's our civil rights director. She's a lawyer. She was born and raised in Key West. Her parents are Cuban and ran an incredible restaurant down there, and now her family runs a restaurant up here. And if I hope you don't mind my saying, it's called La Yuma. And boy, if you want Cuban food, you go to La Yuma. Well, La Yuma is in Lutz, Florida, which is a suburb near
Lutz.
I grew up in a town where we say Lutz, but you're right, it's Lutz, and it's near Busch Gardens, a little bit to the west and north of Busch Gardens. It's close by. But Tanya Clevenger is I don't even know how she gets everything done. She's just coming back from maternity leave with her little baby, Althea.
And what's the name of the restaurant again?
La Yuma.
La Yuma.
La Yuma.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Y'all heard that restaurant name? So let's patronize that.
Go there and have the carne asado.
Okay, the next picture is Who is this guy?
I think that's going to be Hassan Shibli again. Whom we already spoke. And you'll see him in a little bit different setting here, because in the other one he was more informally addressed, and here he's in a more formal setting on our behalf. This is a man whose energy is boundless. He covers such a broad spectrum and goes all over the state in ways that the rest of us can't even keep up with. Okay. And he always does it in a way that proclaims the decency of people who are trying to understand each other with Islam as a backdrop.
Okay, on the last picture is a gentleman named Muhammad Ali. Picture number seven picture. This guy.
Oh, that's Wilfredo Ruiz. Oh, there's me, but that's Wilfredo Ruiz.
But I see honoring Muhammad Ali, Palm Beach County.
I can't tell you. That's probably someone he's commenting about. But Wilfredo works out of the Southeast Florida office primarily, but around the state. Wilfredo was an Islamic chaplain in the Navy. He is a lawyer, but he doesn't work as a lawyer for us. He can, but he doesn't.
So are you top people attorneys?
Well, let me put it this way, and this is just me as a matter of pride being a lawyer. I think when you have someone with a legal background involved in things, they have a different understanding, and it causes them to be a little more cautionary, not to take as many risks or do things that are strange or unusual, because they know they have to stay within the bounds of the ethics of the law. And he does in great
being
ways.
Being an immigration attorney, he only practices for the federal courts.
Yes, I'm limited. And it's only a federal practice anyway. I don't know of any state that has an immigration court unless they are violating the U.S. Constitution.
My other questions are a little bit more detailed.
Oh, by the way, this other person, if it's on the screen, is a very handsome person. That's me.
That's your brother?
No, he's better looking than I am.
Now, back to my question.
My brother, by the way, was a member of the Pittsburgh Steelers years ago. He's much more muscular and handsome than me.
CARE gets only donations.
Yes.
There's no enterprises being ran?
No.
What's the budget size here in Tampa?
Currently, I'm going to be very loose with that and answer that generally, because it's grown each year because of the needs. For instance, before I came on board, we had we started out with, I think, two or three people that grew, and now we have a staff of well over 20. We're getting closer to 30.
They're all salaried people.
Statewide. Some are salaried, some are volunteers, some are interns
so
from law schools.
So the fundraiser amount is roughly?
And we end up, we're currently somewhere in the $1 million range now, and it's not enough. Because of all the work we continue to do. When we had a smaller staff and a smaller reach and smaller needs in terms of addressing the needs of the community at large, we could do it for less money. But particularly this year, since the beginning of this year, our work has exploded. We've been getting over 50 calls a day just for lawyers in our offices.
Do you charge people who come to you for?
We charge on sort of like what you, I guess you'd call a sliding scale. If they're unable to pay, we don't charge at all.
So let's say my case, I make like $10,000 a year. How much would I be charged?
The odds of you being charged anything are very small.
And what?
We would hope you might make a donation, but I doubt if we charge you.
And what dollar level do you start charging folks?
Well, it will depend again on their affordability and their circumstances, because it's not just a dollar level. Are they married? How many children do they have? What are they trying to support right now? What are they coming from?
But those that have the resources, so, why would they come to you instead of going to an outside attorney?
Frankly, we might send them outside, because we do refer several things to other places because it's beyond our footprint. It takes more girth than we have.
It's more than your pay grade.
Yeah, but, well, not beyond our pay grade, but beyond the time investment that we have to that we're required to use for other resources. But that said, for those who end up using us for their legal services, particularly immigration services, it's about one-fourth to one-fifth of what they would pay a regular immigration lawyer. Oh, yes, much less.
So if I got rounded up,
yeah,
I can come to you guys and pay nothing.
You might be able to bluff your way through, and we might be able to go for that, too. But we try to sort it out so that we're working with people who are in real need financially, whose needs we're able to meet. And at the same time, there are people who have real means, but they come to us anyway. And they pay, and we charge them accordingly. And they're very good about it, because they believe they're supporting CARE. We think that's important, too.
Mm-hmm. And you've been an attorney there for a year and a half now?
No, I've been there. I've been involved with them at a distance at this point for close to a year and a half, and have been there on the staff for about a year now.
You're full-time there now?
Yes.
How often do you go down to the jail to get folks out of jail?
I don't go to jail, because that would require being a Florida lawyer, I can go to a federal facility like Chrome over in Miami, where a lot of our people who are taken in sometimes in detention by ICE go.
But here in Tampa, there's no federal lockup here in Tampa, is there?
Well, there is. There is, and there's a federal court here in Tampa.
So they're locked up in the bottom of the courtroom?
But in a way, I guess that's one way to think of it. But we tend not to run into that very much. When we run into it at all, it is in the form of someone who somehow has an affiliation with care or a need for care who contacts us, who has somehow been taken into custody because of something having to do with their immigration status.
Okay, now here, there are marks here.
Yes.
What, five here?
At least five, yeah.
Now, are there FBI spies in these malls, you think?
I think that's so funny because what we constantly run into is when we meet with people from the FBI and other organizations, and we have liaison meetings with all kinds of different groups all the time, and they're very productive. And one thing we respond to when we're asked in terms of how we can all get along better and do more together is, please don't try to use us or the mosques around here as your spies, as your informants.
So you assume that all the mosques do not have FBI spies in them?
I have no idea. I'm too busy to find out, quite frankly. But we try to convince them, don't try to use us for that. Don't leverage us into that. That's not why we're here. We're Americans, and or people who are trying to become Americans, and we want to be a part of this country and help, and we'll do that.
You think they honor that request?
Think there are what?
You think they honor your request of not having spies in the mosques?
That I can't speak to. I don't spend a lot of time in mosques. I spend my time in the office.
In the courtroom, the federal courthouse.
Well, I spend it in immigration court, and I spend it with what's called the USCIS, U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Service. They have an office here in Tampa and several others in the state.
Do you think the judges in federal court that have immigration are fair judges?
I think they're really good. I will tell you, I think I don't know how they do it. The workload these people are facing.
The federal judges.
Yes, and the difficulties and the complexity of the issues they have to deal with. I am always impressed with the work they do. I think there are probably some outliers we can always name. There's always someone out there somewhere who looks like they're a bit of a renegade and doesn't seem to have a real understanding of civics the way we learned it when we were in school. But I think by and large, and then some, they are dedicated and good public servants.
Mm-hmm. Well, overall, why do you think that people in Tampa and elsewhere in America have this questionable fear of Islamic people?
I think it's part of the fear of the unknown, and let me page back on that. I came into things like this doing civil rights work, and in college I was involved with the ACLU. Mm-hmm. By the way, CARE is involved with the ACLU and other organizations like that, and we all work together and we try to do things and pass things to each other and help each other from time to time in Florida and around the country. But I came in that way, and I came in what you and I would call the civil rights era. I was doing it mostly in the South. I had the good fortune two times during that time to literally physically in my presence meet Dr. King, who has inspired me all my life. And
so why this fear of a Muslim?
And what I recall from that period is what I see today. People are afraid of what they don't know and who they don't know. When people get to know each other, when they get to work side by side, when those things happen, all these other things fall away and they realize I'm working with another human being. And then I ask myself this question. Let's say somebody is whatever religion they are, whether they're Muslim or Christian or Buddhist or whatever they happen to be. Wouldn't you want to be working with somebody who says, I have this as my faith? That tells me there is some moral base to them that goes beyond just
but
something.
But it seems like when there's a Muslim related incident, whether they're calling folks over or shooting, mm-hmm. it's the treat. One Muslim Islamic person shoots, let's say, one person. The tree more harshly than Anglo-Saxon that kills 59 people.
Just exactly the way we behaved in the 60s and way before that when any person of color was involved in any crime of violence. If somebody was shot in town, it didn't matter if a black person did it, they got accused anyway. We all lived through that and we all saw that and we all marched about it and we all worked on it and it took time and we're still working on it in a lot of ways, but we've come so far and I see us even now coming forward in that way. And that's one of the reasons I'm at CARE. Because to me, CARE and organizations like it that are involved in Islamic issues is ground zero for where we as human beings need to be and need to go.
So the fear factor is based on the unknown.
Oh, absolutely. Or what we've decided we don't want to know. Okay. When we make things up or we hear somebody else and we subscribe to what they say without thinking or checking it out, and we hear expressions like Sharia law and things like that don't really exist. When we do those things, then we become part of the polyglot of misinformation and disinformation, and we become part of the problem. But we work ourselves out of that. Yesterday was a good example of that, don't you think, with what happened in Virginia, as for example.
Sure.
I say that because I worked in Virginia elections and politics while I was there in college and law school. And it was so wonderful, frankly, to see the public respond to negative concepts and precepts about people, including on immigration issues.
Didn't have an ad with a truck with a Confederate flag on it running down the street and folks running from the truck.
Yes. And it didn't work. In fact, in places like Henrico County, a place with which I'm familiar, that would ordinarily vote in a very particular direction, they went the other way, probably in part because they saw that and said, no, that's not who we are. That's not how we understand the world. That's not right.
Okay,
people know the difference between
right
and
wrong. We gotta be winding this down now.
Yeah.
And I certainly thank you for being on the show.
Thank you.
Do you want to give me your phone number?
Well, I'll leave the care number if you'd like.
Sure.
It's 813-514-1414.
You repeat it again?
813-514-1414.
Can you repeat your name again slowly?
I'm Bob Sichta. I'm an attorney at CARE, and we have many people there who can help you with your issues. And if we can't, hopefully we can at least get you to someone who can.
Thank you for being on the show today.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
I repeated my disclosure about we being Tampa's last place news, but you may notice I look a little bit different today. Because, know why? I'm in a real studio, and the women here made me up with makeup. You know, all kind of brushes and eye gloss things, and so that's the difference. So if you're guessing, kind of Al McCray looks enhanced. Well, that's the reason. We're finally made to cable now. Yes, we're on cable now. We have made the big time after 7 years of restaurants and hotels and judges' chambers. So I hope you continue to watch me. If you go to TampaNewsAndTalk.com, click Talk Shows, you can see all my shows going back 7 years. That's right, 7 years. But our new home now is at the Tampa Bay Arts and Education Channel now. So thanks again for watching. And stay tuned for our next show.